no one is here yet, but my guess is that that's pretty indicative of where the world is right now. So knowing someone's love language helps us to be better neighbors, better friends, as well as better intimate partners if we're in such a relationship. Because then we can understand how to express love in the most powerful way possible for that person. And it varies from person to person. So as we go through too, I'll share with you kind of my love language preferences. And words of affirmation are not it for me. And in part, it's because of my upbringing. That in my home, growing up, words and actions didn't always match. And so over time, I learned that when someone says one thing and then does another, I think it's practice what you preach. At least in my house it is, so. And that when those don't match, when they're polar opposites even, I always say go with what someone does over what they say, because that's really where their heart is in their actions. Now, that may not always be true, but it's, in my experience, has been true enough that's kind of where I've ended up. And so words just tend to fall flat and insincere for me, even when they're not meant to. It's a perhaps even a defense mechanism that I've built up over time. However, I've had to learn how to use words of affirmation in adulthood. Because you know the old phrase, opposites attract? Well, words are Abby's love language. And so I've had to learn how to do that. So, and the worst part, see, sometimes it's nice that she's in another church. But the worst part are the trap questions, right? Like, you know, does this dress make me look fat? Right? Okay, come on, some of you said that. Or, you know, was that burnt toast? Did that taste good? You know, right? Does this new haircut make me look pretty? You know, those are trap questions, right? Anybody with me? It's okay. Yeah, you're all like, yeah, well, my spouse is here. I can't say anything. But when you get home, it'll be all right. Well, if your loved one's primary way of receiving love is through words, then you have to be careful in how you respond to questions like these. And take it from someone who has the voice of experience. You got to learn how to do it right. And it's important, not just to stay out of trouble or out of the doghouse. It's important because this is someone you love. Whether it's a spouse or a child or a parent or a friend or a neighbor or a colleague. And because the added power that words have to those whose primary love language is words of affirmation, it kind of can create an easy dilemma. And that is to stay affirming of someone without it becoming what I call nice. Right? Ever have those conversations where it's like, oh, they said all the right things, but it just didn't seem right? It was nice, right? We kind of live in that world, and to me that is not affirming. That when words are fake, that's not affirming. Rather, words need to be respectful as well. As I always tell my kids, they need to respect someone enough to tell them the truth. And that is more important. You know, speaking of them, with them being 4.5 hours away from me now, I started doing something because I was missing them. They're probably not missing me, but I'm missing them. And so I started doing a Monday morning text to each of the kids, affirming them in some way to get their school week started off with something positive from Dad. And you can tell that they know words are not my thing. You know, I do other things, and I'll share that with you as we go through. But that I think they're just confused. What have you done with my dad? And so after I've done this now 3 weeks, and I finally got a happy face emoji from my son and a thank you from my daughter. But it took 3 weeks to even get to that point. And they're teenagers too, so that, you know, right, Logan? Okay. He's never being liturgist again, right? So, all right, anyway, I chose to start off this series with this particular love language, not just to get my own confession out there, although that's a part of it, but because of the power that words have in our societal dialogue. You know, let me just put it out there. I don't think that words of affirmation are our president's love language. However, I do think that that's how he receives love. Saying something affirming to him, he hears that. But I don't think that's the way in which he expresses love. And in fact, you know, I think the whole dehumanizing effect of what social media and politics has created is a situation where we're now with, if you disagree with me 1%, or on one vote, then you're now an enemy combatant. Sam Brownback was really good with this too. Social media, any venue of it, is so impersonal, right? I'm not saying this to you, I'm saying it in a text line and then hitting post. No harm, no foul. It feeds our passive-aggressive tendencies, and it dehumanizes the person on the receiving end. And yet, when you look at comments on posts on social media, even in the newspaper, they used to have, and I don't know that, when I was in the Wichita area, the Eagle used to have a comment section, and you could put in your comments to things. Oh, 95 to 98% of all of the comments made were negative. So this is why I feel like the words that we say are important, and that if we are to be followers of Christ, that we must follow what Paul writes, that our words matter. In fact, one of the causes of teen suicide these days is what's called cyberbullying, where people post something online to their account, and as a result of that, the child either succeeds or attempts suicide. And talk about how powerful words can be. To be so powerful that you want to end your life, that should be a sign and a signal for all of us as followers of Jesus of how we need to conduct ourselves. You know, our social fabric has been stained by this and by people who call themselves Christians. And yet, one of the solutions is, what if we called people first, rather than use a descriptor first? Let me just give you an example. And I learned this from a ministry in Southern Ohio that deals with people who are, and this is how they say it, people who are experiencing homelessness. They're not homeless. They're people who are experiencing homelessness. Can you hear the difference in that? And just to be called a person is a powerful thing. To be able to say, you are a person. You are created in the same image, and God loves you just as much as me. Some people go their entire lives without ever hearing that. And yet they're around people who say, we follow Christ all the time. And I think this is where the words of Paul come in and help us out. Right, he writes in 4:29, go ahead, Scott. This is the way the NRSV puts it. Right, let no evil talk come out of your mouth, but only what is useful for building up, as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. If I had this in my home growing up, words would probably be much easier for me. But that wasn't my experience. I bet it's not been everybody's experience here too. I like the way that the message translation is to try to update things and to put them in a more contemporary language. And I love how Eugene Peterson, who wrote that, puts this same verse. Watch the way you talk. Let nothing foul or dirty come out of your mouth. I almost think that he should update it and say, out of your thumbs as well, right? Yeah. Say only what helps. Each word is a gift. Wow. That's powerful right there. So what Paul is teaching here is that words should not be used as a stick or a stone. That words shouldn't be used to harm anyone else. Boy, where would our political dialogue be if all those who are running and saying they're good Christians followed that? I don't know on either side if anybody follows that, so it's not a jab at any particular person. Even tough words, such as constructive criticism, should be voiced in such a way to see the person on the other end of that as a person. As an equal. Right, doctors have to share some not so nice news at times. And all the doctors that I've spoken with about how do they handle a terminal diagnosis, right, a cancer diagnosis, how do they handle that? And they use different words, but it's all, we dread it. It is not why we went to school, is to tell people that their life is going to end. Right? In fact, the Hippocratic Oath even says it's not about that. It's to extend life and quality of life. And yet, one doctor, my doctor in Lindsberg, put it to me this way. He says, but they deserve to know. I would want to know if I had such a diagnosis. So going back, Scott, can you put that back up? Scott, can you put that back up? That's all right. That's fine. This is not evil talk or foul or dirty. This is truth. And that language and those conversations aren't about tearing someone down, it's about being honest. So words of affirmation can be tough words as long as they're meant for building up. I think teachers have this same dread or loathing about talking with children that are underperforming in school and dealing with parents. And no teacher that I've ever talked to has said, man, I just really love it when I have to have a parent-teacher conference with someone who, you know, Johnny's not performing up to measure. But yet, Johnny's got a lot of life, and he needs to know what his potential is. And the same goes, the same ideal of building up and sharing nothing foul or dirty out of our mouth goes to the same thing with our love relationship with God. Through our baptism, we are given affirmation of being in the family of God. And either we or our parents used words to affirm our love relationship in our baptism with our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. And when we become members of the church, we use words to affirm a love relationship with a community of faith as we take a place in it. And so through this, if we lived up to this potential, then the love of God and the love of neighbor that is called the Great Commandment, well, that could become our basis of creating authentic Christian community. You know, reading through the Bible lets us read God's words of affirmation for us as inheritors of Jesus's ultimate love act. And lastly, each and every one of us has the ability to share words with God at all times. In another passage of Scripture, Paul writes, we pray without ceasing, right? Prayer is the way in which we offer God our words of affirmation. And prayer can be simple or complicated. Mostly, in my case, prayer tends to go rabbit trail to rabbit trail. But that's okay, too. That's how God made me. Prayer can be singular and focused. That would be nice sometimes. Or it can be scattered or complex. Right? Depending on whatever's going on in your life at that particular moment, your prayer should reflect that. And it's okay to share your emotions with God. If you're mad, let God know. If you're angry, let God know. If you're joyous, let God know. Who here doesn't think God doesn't already know it? And so the sharing of that with God is really for our benefit, to claim it, to own it, and then you can do something with it. Releasing it in prayer, whatever it is affirming. It means you're a real person, just as God created you to be. And God also likes to hear words of gratitude in our prayers. Sometimes that gets missing in our prayers. I know it does in mine. It's easy for me to lay it all out and all the problems and then I forget to be thankful. And even if it's just a simple thank you to God, God wants to hear that too. So this is God's offering for us on this day, to use our words to build up and to lift up, and to use our words carefully as a way in which we show and express love. So now let us be in an attitude of offering ourselves to God as the ushers come upon us. As mentioned earlier, this is also the third Sunday of the month, so our Helping Hands ministry will be distributing their buckets, so to help. A couple Sundays ago, I was here a little late, and I had a knock on the door, and it was a man traveling, trying to get back to Salt Lake City, and he had run out of gas. And he had his daughter and granddaughter with him, just the three of them. And we sat and visited for a little bit. And when he left here with a tank of gas in his van, he was in tears. So what you do makes a difference. So let us pray. God, as we receive this morning's offering, let it not just be the ways in which we transact the financial business of the church, but let it also be a way in which we are spiritual givers, givers of ourselves, and actually givers of what you give to us, so that others may be blessed, and that others may be shown grace, and that others may be shown that they are indeed a real person. So may you bless what we give at this moment, as well as the ways in which we give throughout the week, in our time, in our talents, the use of our hands and our feet, in our eyes and our ears and our tongues, so that all may be an offering to you. All in Jesus' name, amen. Please join him. Wonderful words of life.
just going to make a quick announcement. Patrick announced that I'd be in the narthex for questions. I think it's best if we meet in here. That's a little bit more comfortable setting after church, and we'll kind of do like we did last week. That gives everybody a chance to sit in here and listen and ask questions.
Sounds good. So as you go forth, either after visiting with Brad or now, may you go out to do all the good that you can, and by all the means that you can, and all the ways that you can, and all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. So may the Holy Spirit be upon you to do just that. Amen.